roaring in the morning sun, searching for a longer day. People feeling like the light has just come. We must never stop the way, yeah. Birds chirping and I hear my name, grasping into a life. Life is happy but it's so insane. We must merely make a start. Savannah, I'm coming home. Savannah, we'll never be alone. Savannah, the beauty of the world. Savannah, let's all take a ride. Savannah.
So this month I have Julie with me, who's one of our volunteers that lives in Baucau. And we're sitting this morning in Santa Cruz Cemetery. So Santa Cruz Cemetery is the site of the Santa Cruz Massacre that happened on November 12, 1991. Indonesian troops opened fire on civilians that were attending a funeral ceremony. And much of the massacre was documented by international journalists that had come because tensions had been really high in Dili at the time. The tapes were hidden and then later released and published worldwide, which spurred a lot of international response after, at that time, the 16-year Indonesian, brutal Indonesian occupation. Julie's here to talk to us about death and dying and funerals in Timor-Leste. What are some of the things that you do at site?
At site, I'm partnered with a blacksmith, so I help them with some business skills, teaching them some marketing skills, financial skills, cost analysis. I also work with an ocean college. I teach them some web design and consult with them on some library improvements that they're making. Teach English to some kids, teach spelling to some kids. I attend a lot of funerals.
Can you describe your experiences with death and funerals in Timor-Leste so far?
Yes, I don't know if it's too cliche for me to say that my life in Timor began with death. But it really did. 5 days after I moved to site in Baucau, my oldest host brother died in a motorcycle accident. And then at least one extended family member or a village member died at a rate of about one a week for 12 weeks. So I became more familiar with death and dying than I ever have ever had.
Can you give us sort of a general timeline of the events that happened once you got to site?
Yeah. So the death and mourning process, I guess it's better to say the mourning process, lasts generally about a year, but within that 12-month time period, it's kind of chunked down. Like the day my host brother died, that night, all the family and friends came, the house was filled, and it's interesting to point out that in Timor-Leste, the death rate is pretty high. There aren't any funerary services here, so the family has to take on that role themselves. So my host family's home essentially became their own funeral home, or what they call a demakema. And that night, the male friends and younger male family members actually were responsible for preparing the body for a placement in the coffin. So they had to remove his little clothes, they had to wash his body, redress him, and actually place him in the coffin. And while the men were doing that, the women were preparing the altar on which the coffin would sit. They were preparing the coffin itself in terms of lining it. Sometimes they put some pillows or sheets or tights. They pick very specific flowers to go inside the coffin. Elder men, fathers, uncles, grandfathers, are actually preparing the grave. And so they hand dig the grave. They prepare the house, the exterior of the home to receive guests. Normally in America, we don't do that process.
Yeah.
They do that themselves. And almost at the same time, you know, words being spread, family members, friends are starting to come. Women set to cooking and baking and just nonstop. So the first 3 days, that's kind of what it is. They take the term to have a wake. Pretty literally. During the day, friends and family come and they kind of move through stations of paying respects to the deceased and the family members. And whether it's planned or not, I don't know. But oftentimes they'll say at least part, sometimes an entire rosary, and they'll sing, and sometimes toward the end, I don't know if it's planned or if it's just the emotion of it all, but they just cry and sob and wail, but the wailing takes on this, it's like a song in and of itself. It's very melodic. Sitting and drinking coffee, and then they move and go have lunch. And then they move one last time and have some more coffee before they go home. But during the night, the body is never left unattended. Family and friends are there up around the clock, just keeping vigil.
I don't know if every family does this or not, but my host family
set up an altar inside their living room with photos of my host brother, and always had the candle lit. Like, it was a big deal. Like, you don't let that candle go out. Someone's always watching the candle. Sometimes they sit out small plates of food or even cups of coffee or tea, whatever the family and friends are eating or drinking, we all serve. And then on the third day, they bury the body. My family had a traditional Catholic mass. My brother's friends had to carry his casket kind of up and over the hill to the grave site. After that, there are a few ceremonies that happen in between. So the 1 week anniversary is what they call Ifunamu. So they take bitter flowers to the grave. Second week is Ifunamidar, sweet flowers. And then after that, every month, it's kind of the same. Family, friends go, they clean off the grave, put fresh flowers, say some prayers. Sometimes they sing songs. And it's like that up until maybe the very last month. But in between that, I don't know if you know about the 40-day. It's different from each family, at least from what I understand. But my family, on the 40th day after my brother's death, they actually had a marathon dog ceremony.
Oh, wow.
And they did it for two reasons. The first was there were a lot of questions. My host brother was only 21 when he died, healthy for all intents and purposes. So they wanted to get answers from the marathon dog about why did this happen or trying to make sense. And then the other reason they called it the marathon dog was actually to do a blessing over the house to protect the family if lived during the next year and like nothing else bad would befall. So the last special event is on the 12th month, is what is called a Kormepan, which you got to go to Karma.
Yeah.
And they prepare for the Kormepan at least 2 months in advance, or at least my family did. They rebuilt the grave from the ground up. They made this beautiful, what's called a rate umo, which is essentially a grave palm. Not unlike kind of like what you see around here. It's very large and elaborate. And started receiving cows and pigs and goats in order to feed all of the grass that they were anticipating. They say it takes a village to raise a child, and they take that pretty literally too.
Yeah.
So my host brother was everyone's son, or everyone's brother.
Because you came into the situation pretty early on in your service, where you had lots of deaths in your family, what do you perceive, or what was your role as a family member and as a Peace Corps volunteer?
Early on, it was just a shock, because I was prepared to get to know my host family and, you know, my neighbors, and I ended up meeting hundreds and hundreds of people, and their expression of grief is very different from what I'm used to. They're very public with their mourning. It's not, I feel in America, where it's a very private, almost internalized experience. And here it's very much public. Men, women, children all cry and mourn, I think, at least what I've witnessed, with equal amounts of passion and just pain. Which again, maybe it's just my family back home, but like we're very reserved in our mourning.
Yeah,
I feel like it's much healthier because it seems it's a very communal sharing of pain. And there's a lot of support. And it doesn't matter if you're related or not. Like everybody, like I said, he was everyone's son or everyone's brother, so everyone's there. My role is primarily as an observer, just to kind of take it all in, because I didn't know what else to do. And my host dad is very supportive in that I learn the culture and experience the culture, and he was very open. He's like, take photos, take videos. He was like, ask questions. He's like, if there's something like you don't understand, ask. So those were the roles I took. I would observe, I would take a lot of photos, take a lot of videos. So it was almost anthropological. I wrote a lot just to help me process it all. Because I felt like I was in the way, really.
Yeah.
Again, there was just so many people, and my host family, they just got me, you know, Peace Corps does a good job of saying, like, you need to do this with your volunteers.
Yeah.
I remember, like, Amma being really concerned about, like, making sure I ate.
Yeah.
I was like, oh my gosh, don't worry about me.
Yeah.
But as time went on, I guess, even during those first 3 days, I ended up helping to serve. So during the mate, like tons of people come, you have to feed them. So I was invited back with the other young women to help carry out sodas or cakes and things to the guests and to like take the empties away and carry those back. So that was nice because that gave me something to do.
Yep.
As the month went on, I'd always go with them to like a monthly visits to the grange. And again, I'll pause and always be like, take photos. And then by the time the parmesan came around, they included me much more in the actual cooking process, which was nice. I felt like I had made some
strides. Integrated,
yeah. Exactly. Yeah, they had me out on the back porch cutting all the vegetables. I got to fry up some meat. So yeah, that was my role. My host family also really did their best to take me in as one of their own as much as they should and as much as I was able.
Can you describe what a parmesan is?
Yeah, so kormapam in Tajin actually translates into removing the black. And so after someone died, they wear black. And some families wear head to toe black, black pants, black shirt for an entire year. Some families choose to wear what are called lutu. Yep. You might have one on, yeah.
Yeah, for Kevin's grandma.
Yeah, so pieces of black cloth either around the wrist or around the neck. I ended up having to wear a pinned lutu across my heart. They're under lutu for the 12 months, and basically that means for 12 months there's no dancing. So it's just a reminder. They do a lot with remembrance here. To remind themselves and to let other people know that they're in mourning.
Yeah.
During the kormapam, it's a big deal to remove the black. So graveside, the afternoon of the kormapam, my host mom, my host dad, and my host dad's brother, and their father, all took off their black shirts. And my host mom had a white shirt on underneath, but my host dad and my grandfather, the leonine or the keeper of the family
crest,
sure, of the culture. He actually put on the white shirt on my dad and on my uncle. So it's very ceremonial. It's light. It's like the heaviness has kind of been lifted. They can dance again. The other thing, yes, I didn't mention yet, but since my host brother died in a motorcycle accident, one of the very traditional, I believe it's, he lost some blood at the crash site, and so they had to go back and collect as much as they could. But they expect that they aren't going to be able to collect all of it, so they have to, they also make a little roadside grave in the remembrance of where he acted the site of his death. So now, whenever my dad comes in to Dilly, he always stops the bus next, and he always sits a cigarette out on the grave. And you can see some friends have left beer on top of the grave. So, yeah, it's very interesting. They keep the person alive as much as they absolutely can.
So one final question is, how have these experiences shaped your sport experience?
It's a very bonding experience to go through that kind of process, and for them to see me show up, you know, event after event. I think through that they got to know me better, I got to know them better. Certainly better understanding. There was a lot of cultural exchange.
Yeah.
I remember a lot of family members asking, like, well, do you guys do this in America? Which I think was great. And of course, that's part of Peace Corps' role too, right? You know, cultural exchange. And I'm in a much better place now that I've been here a year, and I still have another year to go, that I don't think I would be where I am within my community, so to speak, if I hadn't had all of those funerals to go to.
Well, thank you for joining us this morning.